Amen. As we continue, we're actually concluding our series on Ecclesiastes this morning. And so we'll read from chapter 12 in just a moment. Next Sunday begins a new series on the book of James. And if you've been using those little scripture journals, the thin black copies of Ecclesiastes that have scripture on one side and blank note pages on the other, we will have those available for the book of James. In fact, they're available today. And so you can pick them up for a donation of $5 at a couple kiosks out the door. But now hear the word of the Lord from Ecclesiastes 12, verses 9 through 14. Besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth. The words of the wise are like goads, and like nails firmly fixed are the collected sayings. They are given by one shepherd. My son, beware of anything beyond these. Of making many books there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil. This is the word of our God. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we bow down before you. We worship you. You are the only holy God. And we come to your holy word. And it is an amazing grace that you have given us your word. These words of instruction, these words of challenge, these words of comfort, and these good news, these words of good news that are not just for us, but for all, every tongue, tribe, and people. Now, Father, we pray that you would use your word this morning by your power, by your spirit working in us, that you would instruct us, that you would challenge us, that you would comfort us, that you would change us and move us to love you more and to show the fruit that comes from changed hearts. Father, I pray you would speak through Pastor Trent as he labors this morning, as he teaches, as he illustrates. Father, speak through him to us. It's in Jesus' name and for his glory we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
What have I become, my sweetest friend? Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt, if I could start again a million miles away. I would keep myself, I would find a way.
I don't know about you, but I'm going to miss hearing Johnny Cash every week before I preach. It's been really a pleasure. Anyway, you can still find him out there on YouTube. He's got a song or two that's available. Before he was the famous singer and songwriter, John Mayer was playing a gig at a local Borders bookstore in the Atlanta area where he lived. And on his way to this gig, he realized, driving down Interstate 85, that he had forgotten his guitar. And as he's driving down the interstate, he looks back at the interstate going the opposite direction, back toward his apartment. And if you know Atlanta, you can imagine what the traffic, bumper to bumper, looked like on the way back. And he just decides he's not going to turn around. It's not worth it to go back to get his guitar. He ends up borrowing one. He plays the gig. But the whole experience causes him to reflect on whether he's made a mistake pursuing life as a musician. And out of this reflection on his life, he writes a song that became quite famous, one of my favorite of his, called Why Georgia. And the song goes like this. He sings, "It might be a quarter-life crisis or just the stirring in my soul. Either way, I wonder sometimes about the outcome of a still verdictless life. Am I living it right? Am I living it right? You grammar police, that's not grammatically correct. Should be an adverb, rightly. We'll give him room for creative license. What he says there, thinking about the outcome of a still verdictless life, he recognizes that one day there will be a verdict on his life. He doesn't know what that verdict is going to be, but it causes him to ask the question, am I living it right in light of the fact that there will be a verdict declared on my life? And it's a great question for us to ask as well. Am I living it right? Now, there might be some who hear that, and even that idea kind of bothers you a little bit. It rubs you the wrong way because you're like, well, who's to say what living right is? And can anybody really know how one should, what is it to live right? It's a little presumptuous to even say that there's one right way to live. In fact, the dominant narrative we hear through music and books and movies and so on is that, you know, the right way to live is for you to do you and for you to just do whatever seems right to you, and that's what it means to live right. But I don't think we have as much certainty about that. I don't think that actually gives a lot of peace. Despite how loud it's being said, I'm not sure it's actually helping people feel at ease with how they're living their lives. And I think John Mayer actually captures this really beautifully. He pulls the mask back off his own life to show us some of his own insecurity with the way he's living his life. And he sings in the bridge, he says, so what? So I've got a smile on, but it's hiding the quiet superstitions in my head. Don't believe me. Don't believe me when I say I've got it down. I'm smiling, but underneath, I have no confidence that I'm living it right. I have no idea. And I'm facing the future of this unknown verdict that's going to be laid down on my life, and I don't know what that's going to be. It's really profound what he sees. You may be here today wondering the same thing. Am I living it right? Maybe you're having a quarter life crisis. Maybe it's a midlife crisis. Maybe it's a retirement crisis. Maybe it's a marriage crisis, job crisis. I don't know. But it's caused you to pause and to ask yourself the same question. Am I living it right? What's the verdict on my life going to be at the end? And is there any way to actually know that so I can begin to live my life now in a way that when that verdict is ultimately delivered, it's something I'm going to not be ashamed of? Well, that's what the wisdom literature of the Bible, what this whole book of Ecclesiastes aims to tell us, because there actually is a right way to live. And I'm not talking about the particulars of what your vocation should be or whether you should be married or single or any of those sorts of things, but there is a right way to live. There is the way of wisdom. And no matter how crazy and topsy-turvy and upside down this world seems, there is a right way to live in the midst of it. And that's what this book has been about. And we're going to conclude that with this passage today, by looking at the communication of wisdom, the source of wisdom, and the end of wisdom, so that you can have confidence that you are living it right. And if not, so you can turn around and begin to do so. So let's look at, first of all, the communication of wisdom. We read in verse 9, besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge. So you notice there's a change of voice here. He's been speaking in the first person ever since chapter 1, verse 12, I, the preacher. And now we're reading third person. It's talking about the preacher. And scholars debate whether or not this is still the same person, and he's just shifted from talking about himself in the first person to talking about himself in the third person. And they think he might be doing that because what he's saying about himself is basically commending himself. And it's a little awkward to say, like, what I wrote is awesome. So it's more like, you know, what he wrote is awesome, and he being me, that kind of a thing. Or whether this is actually a separate narrator, and at the end of the day, it actually doesn't matter. The point is, these concluding verses are not written to tell us that everything else that went before in Ecclesiastes that was confusing and difficult and challenging was you know, nonsensical. What it's actually saying is, this is tremendous wisdom. You should listen to what the preacher has to say. What he said is right. It's wise, and it was true, and it's carefully constructed, and so on. So that's the point. And it goes on and says in the rest of verse 9, besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth. He taught the people with great care. He not only was wise, but he shared that wisdom. He communicated that wisdom through teaching and ultimately through writing. Probably the preacher, we've said from the beginning, is King Solomon. We know from 1 Kings 4 that Solomon had composed more than 3,000 proverbs, more than 1,000 songs. And besides that, he had extraordinary knowledge about plants and animals and birds and all kinds of things, so that people from all around the world came to sit at his feet and learn from him. He was not only wise, but he taught and shared his wisdom with others. And that tells us also about the book of Ecclesiastes. This book did not fall out of the sky. It was carefully composed. It was written through hard work and labor. And I think there's a word here for those who labor in preaching and teaching, whether it's Sunday school or small groups or Wednesday night Bible studies or other Bible studies in the course of the week. And it's not the main point of this passage, but I think there's something for us to notice here. And that is that the preacher is commended for the way with great care he weighed and studied and arranged, all for the sake of edifying the people of God. But as you think about those words, weighing and studying and arranging with great care, the other way of describing that is hard work. It's hard work. And if you've taught, if you've sought to instruct others, if you sought to write anything with the aim of teaching people truth, you know, it's not easy. It's hard. And it shouldn't be done haphazardly. It should be done with the kind of great care that it says marked the preacher's teaching. It goes on and it says that he sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth. What a beautiful description of what should characterize our efforts at teaching or through speaking or through writing. When it says he sought to find words of delight, it doesn't mean that he was looking for words to tickle the ears of the people, but he was searching for the right words that would paint a picture of reality to invite the people into and experience the truth of what he's saying. But that seeking wasn't easy. And he wasn't just wanting to paint beautiful words for you. He was actually wanting to uprightly speak words of truth through beauty. It's incredible. For some people, that comes easy, but not many. If you are a teacher, writer, you're aiming to instruct people, particularly teaching people God's word, and you find it really difficult, I just want you to know, you're not doing it wrong. It's really hard. One day I came home to dinner with my family after a very unfruitful time of sermon writing, and they asked me, you know, how's the sermon going? And I, you know, my face is in my soup, and I said something like, I bled words. And it's kind of dark, but I felt really clever when I said it, because it just kind of, you know, after not feeling clever all afternoon, I was like, that was profound. But, you know, it feels like that. It feels like dying frequently. And I think what this, the encouragement here for me, and I hope for you who labor in similar kinds of ministry, is to say, you're not doing it wrong. It's hard, but it's worth it. You're communicating truth to God's people. And so keep at it and keep putting forth that effort with great care, because these are eternal things we're dealing in. I think it's why the Apostle Paul says in 1 Timothy 5:17, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. It's not like for those who have a hobby of preaching and teaching, for those who enjoy preaching and teaching. He uses the word labor. That's what it feels like. And so don't be discouraged, but be encouraged. You're doing it right. It's hard, and it's worth it. The second thing we see about this passage is from this passage is the source of wisdom. And even as we're appreciating the effort that the writer puts into putting this truth together in beautiful words and form, we can't overlook the source. We read in verse 11, "The words of the wise are like goads, and like nails firmly fixed are the collected sayings. They are given by one shepherd." I want to start with those last words, and then we'll go back to the earlier part. They're given by one shepherd. In your English Bible, that's written with a capital S, not a typo. The translators believe that this one shepherd is a reference to the divine author of the wisdom literature that we find in Scripture. And of course, we can extend that beyond just the wisdom literature and say all of Scripture. That's what we read in 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture is breathed out by God. That's the one shepherd. That is the Holy Spirit who has inspired, even we might say expired, breathed out the words that we read on these pages still today. But sometimes we have a understanding of the doctrine of inspiration, the inspiration of Scripture, which is a biblical doctrine, it's true, but we have a misunderstanding of it. And we think that inspiration means that you know, some angel or somebody sat on Solomon's ear, for example, and just whispered into his ear, like, write this. And now write this. And then he's just, just being dictated to. And that's actually not how we understand what scriptural inspiration means. It is true that God speaks directly to his prophets, that he reveals things to them. And in some cases, they are basically reciting what God has spoken to them. But more frequently, what we find are books like Ecclesiastes and Psalms and the book of Esther, which are carefully constructed pieces of literature that clearly had a lot of work and effort put into them as to how they were arranged to be both words of delight that uprightly are communicating truth to us. And what we believe is that not only were these human authors through blood, sweat, and tears composing these things, but at the same time, the Holy Spirit is actually inspiring them to write the very words of God through their unique personalities and experiences. When we read the book of, if we were to look through the Gospels, what we read there is not that they said, you know, God just spoke to me and I'm just writing down what he said, but instead what we discover is these are men who are writing down eyewitness accounts of what they saw. As Luke's writing the book of Acts, he says, you know, I had to go interview people. I'm doing careful research. I'm trying to put this all together for you in an orderly manner so that you can have confidence in the things that you've heard and believed. That's work. As you read about the Apostle Paul reading 2 Corinthians or Philemon, and you study these scriptures, you discover this is some of the most amazing pastoral wisdom you will find anywhere. And you see the angst with which he's carefully crafting and constructing this. And yet, through it all, we believe that it's given by the one shepherd, the Holy Spirit, working through his human instruments. And this shouldn't lessen your view of the inspiration of Scripture. Instead, it should make you stand back and awe and say, oh my goodness, God is amazing. And praise God for his faithful servants who wrote these words under his inspiration to edify and strengthen us. As we think about how the scripture was communicated to us, that we want to see what the scripture actually does. And that's what we read in the next verses, in the earlier part of that verse. It says, the words of the wise, in verse 11, are like goads, and like nails firmly fixed are the collected sayings. So when talking about the words of the wise and the collected sayings, he's specifically again talking about Ecclesiastes particularly and the other wisdom literature around with it. But as we've already seen, all of the scriptures are given by the one shepherd. So we can expand, I think, and say that what he's talking about here is true about all of scripture that comes to us from God, including this Ecclesiastes and the other wisdom books. And here's how they function. On the one hand, they function like goads. In case you're not familiar with the use of goads, goad was a long pointy stick with a sharp end to it, and it was used by shepherds and farmers to basically poke animals and to make them go where they wouldn't otherwise go. So you got cattle that needs to move, you poke it with this goad, and the cow, finding it uncomfortable to remain getting poked, moves. It's not very complicated how this works. And he says, this is what the words of the wise are like. They're like sharp sticks that poke you and make you uncomfortable where you are and move you from where you are to where you need to be. And that's how the scriptures function in the lives of God's people. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, again, all scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness so that the man of God may be complete and equipped for every good work. You know what correction and reproof feels like? It feels like getting poked. It's uncomfortable. It might even be painful. But it's not meant to harm you. It's meant to move you to a better place, to the place where God intends for us to be. And that's what scripture does. If you're reading scripture and you never find yourself uncomfortable, you never feel like God is poking you and trying to move you, you're not reading it right. Because that's what the words of the wise that are communicated to us through scripture and through good preaching and so on, the teaching, all that's what it does. It pokes and prods us. But that's not all it does. He says that they're also like nails firmly fixed. What a great image of what the words of the wise are like. When we think about the function of nails, if you want to build a house out of wood, you need nails, or at least something that functions like nails. You can have a bunch of wood and you can stack that wood, but if you want to build a house to live in from wood, you need nails because nails hold things that are separate together. The truths of God's word hold all the various parts of life together and enable us to build a meaningful life in which we can live. That's what the words of scripture are like for us. They're like the nails that hold all of the parts of life together so that we can build a meaningful life in this crazy world. Even now. What are these nails? What are these truths? I want to boil it down to just six particular ones. You know, everybody in this world lives in the world with a set of presuppositions, with an understanding of the way things are. They have answers to the six questions I'm about to share with you that they maybe have never even thought about, but they actually have an answer. And it may not be a coherent answer, and it may not be consistent with the other answers to these questions, but all of us live in this world with some, again, presuppositions around which we're building our life. And I believe that the Christian's answer to these questions, the ones that are revealed to us in Scripture, are actually the ones that truly do hold everything together better than any competing answers or ideas or worldviews or understandings. So let me just talk about what those six are and the nails that I believe help to hold our lives together in this world. The first question that everybody needs an answer to is, who am I? Who am I? It's the question of identity. And if there's any question in our cultural moment right now that people feel less certain about, it's the answer to this question. Who am I? And the Bible gives us a clear answer about who you are. Whether you're a Christian or you're not, this is who you are. You are a man or a woman created in the image of the invisible God. And therefore, you are unique among all the rest of his plant and animal creation because you alone were made to reflect and represent the glory of God in this world. That's who you are. The second question then is, where am I? Where am I? And the answer the Bible gives to this question is that you are in a world that God himself created to dwell in with the people he created. And it's a place of amazing wonder and provision and beauty. And yet, at the same time, it's not all quite the way it's supposed to be. And we all are aware of that at some level. The third question then is, why am I here? And that's very much connected with the first question about who you are. And the Bible's answer to the question, why are you here, is that you are here as the image of the invisible God to make him visible in the world through the way that you reign and rule over this creation, through the way you live in relationship with him and with other people and with all of the rest of creation, through the way you reflect and represent into this world his goodness, his beauty, his justice, his wisdom, his truth. That's why you're here. In short, you're here to glorify and enjoy him forever. That's why you're here. That's your purpose. No matter who you are. The fourth question is, what's the problem? We recognize there's something not quite right about this place. We recognize there's something not quite right about me and about you. What is the problem? And how you answer that question is huge. Everybody has ideas. Everybody living on this planet has a belief about what the problem is. The Bible's answer to what the problem is that we all, like sheep, have gone astray from the shepherd. That God created us to be in a relationship with him, and right from the very beginning, our very first parents rebelled against our King, our God, and plunged all of the rest of creation into a state of sin and misery from which we cannot extricate ourselves. And consequently, we are not only slaves of sin and our worst desires and passions, but we are also under the sentence of death from which no one comes back. It's a problem. All of creation groans under its bondage to decay on account of man's rebellion against God. That's the problem. Well, then what's the solution? If you agree that that's the problem, then there is only one solution. And it's the solution that's laid out for us in the scripture, and it's this: that man being helpless to save himself or this good creation that God made, God himself became man. And he stepped into this world, and he bore the judgment and justice against our rebellion and sin that we deserved, so that we who were guilty could actually be set free from our condemnation, even ultimately be set free from our bondage to death. By taking that upon himself, by taking our sins to the cross, by rising again from the dead on the third day and overcoming the power of death, so that all who will receive the righteousness he freely gives by faith alone will not only be pardoned of all their sins, but declared righteous and granted an entry into a relationship with God and the world that he is recreating. The effects of this extend not only to everyone who believes, but it's good news for all of creation. That which has become enslaved will be set free. The sixth question then is, where is it all going? Is there any meaning to this history, or are we just going round and round the circle? And the Bible's answer is, it is all very much going somewhere, and where it's all going is to God dwelling again with his people on a renewed earth where sinners and sin have been once and for all removed. Those who continue to participate in the rebellion against God will be taken away to a place of eternal judgment. Those who have received the forgiveness God freely offers through Jesus will be here to remain forever, reigning with God, glorifying and enjoying him forever. That's where it's all going. The Bible's answers to these questions, I believe, are more compelling than any other answers that are out there. And besides the work of the Holy Spirit causing me to be born again, this is why I'm a Christian. Because I believe these things are true, and I found that these nails are firm, and that they hold my life together, and that in the midst of all of the trials and challenges and suffering and things that I don't understand that happen in this world, these nailed, these firmly fixed things laid down in God's word answer the questions so that even in the midst of the craziness and the things I don't understand, I can build a life that is meaningful before God. And you can too. These things are complex enough to handle all of the most complicated issues in the world, and yet they're simple enough that children can understand and receive them. It's the beauty of what God has written for us in his word. And so it continues in verse 12, and he speaks and says, "My son, beware of anything beyond these, of making many books. There is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh." Beware of anything beyond these. What is he talking about? Is he talking about beware of anything beyond what we find in Ecclesiastes, the wisdom of the church? I don't think so. But I think what he's saying is beware anything beyond the scriptural truths we find revealed in this book. Both the Old Testament and the New Testament. That wasn't what he had in mind, but that's the point. Because the things that are going to be helpful for you in this world are ultimately going to be things that are found in this book. And there's nothing beyond this book that's ultimately going to help you live a life that is right and meaningful in this world. It doesn't mean that you should only study scripture, and it doesn't mean that there's no place for books and so on. But the books that are the best and the ones that are the most helpful for you are the ones that shed the most light on this book and on the truth that's written here. And he says, of the making of books, there's no end. The making of many books, there's no end. He wrote this like 3,000 years ago, before the Gutenberg press, before word processes. I mean, can you imagine what he would think about our world today with the number of books that are published and self-published out there on the market? He would probably say, of the making of many books, there is no end. It's still true. And this is a funny time to announce that I have a book coming out on August 30th. Because why not join the parade of the making of books of no end? Again, he's not saying we need to only study scripture, that there's not value in other books, but the value in them is found in the way they shed light on helping us to understand these fundamental truths. And if you only understand these fundamental truths, it's enough. It's enough. There are those who live in this world always studying, always seeking the next new idea, the next philosophy, the next way of, and there will be people who are coming along, and they're publishing the next thing, the thing that nobody else in all the history of the world and billions of people who've been here, nobody's seen it before, but I see it, and here's what you need to know. And this is the key to living your life. He says, there's no end of that kind of stuff. And those who continually are seeking after those things and looking for some truth beyond the truths that are laid down for us in Scripture, Paul describes them as people who are always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. You don't want to be one of those people. You don't want to be the kind of person who's always studying but never actually grounding yourself in truth. There is value in having an open mind and considering ideas and truths that come to us, but only until we actually land upon truth. G.K. Chesterton said it this way. He said, "The object of opening the mind as with opening the mouth is to shut it again on something solid." There's no virtue in just keeping your mind open and letting truth just pass right through it. But once truth comes to you, clamp down on it, grab a hold of it, don't let it go. And that truth comes to you through God's word. This is the philosophy that you need. These are the firmly fixed nails that will hold your life together. And beware thinking that you'll find anything beyond them, because you won't. And for those of you who are on that search, and you're genuinely searching and you're looking for truth and you're looking for a way to make sense of this world and how to live in it, let me just encourage you with the words of Jesus, who said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." The search for truth will wear you out. Jesus says, "I'll give you the rest for your soul that you're seeking." You're not going to find it in opening another new volume. You're not going to find it by listening to another lecture. You're not going to find it by another accomplishment or achievement. The rest that your soul is desperately seeking is not found in a book. It's found in a person. His name is Jesus. And he invites all of you to come and find your rest in him. Finally, we come to the end of wisdom, and we read in verse 13, "The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man." Some people read these verses as though we've gone through this quagmire of Ecclesiastes, not having any idea what he's talking about. And then we get to the end and he's like, I don't know, just fear God and keep his commandments. But that's not what he's doing here. When he talks about the end, he's talking about the conclusion. He's saying that everything that I've been saying up to this point, it adds up to this. This is the conclusion. Fear God and keep his commandments. I can't remember who it was. I think it was Oliver Wendell Holmes. And I can't even remember exactly what he said, but let me paraphrase his quote. He said, I would not give 2 cents for the simplicity on this side of complexity, but I would give my right arm for simplicity on the other side of complexity. And I think that's exactly what the writer of Ecclesiastes is saying here. He's taken us through the complexity of life in a world that's marked by hevel, by this vaporous mist of our existence, and all of the challenges and the injustice, and how do we understand all these different things, and the fact that we're gonna die, and our life is here, and it's gone, all of that stuff. And then he comes through all of that to this place of simplicity. Here's the end of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. How we understand that phrase, you can translate it a couple different ways. You can translate it as, this is the whole duty of man. This is everything that is expected of you, to fear God and keep his commandments. Or you can translate it as, this is the duty of every man. And actually, both of those things are true. The Bible teaches both of them. On the one hand, God is the rightful king of this universe, and it is a moral universe, and every single person on this planet is responsible for obedience to God's moral law. Every single person on this planet owes God the fear and reverence, the awe that's due him as the creator, maker of all. And every single person will be held to account for that fear and obedience or the lack thereof. At the same time, he says, this is the whole duty of man. And I love that phrase because I think it's very, again, simplifying. When I think about my life, I think about all the different responsibilities and roles and duties that I have. You know, I've got jobs at work as a pastor. I've got responsibilities as a husband, as a father. I've got hobbies and interests that I am interested in pursuing. I got lots of different things that keep me busy in day-to-day things. And sometimes it feels like I'm being pulled in 100 different directions. And then into the midst of all the craziness and not even knowing what I should put on my to-do list today comes this word, fear God and keep his commandments. That's the whole duty. That's it. That's everything. And if you accomplish a million things today, but you don't fear God and keep his commandments, it amounts to nothing. And if you get nothing else done today, but you fear him and you keep his commandments, it's enough. How incredibly helpful and simplifying that statement is. But he goes beyond that. And he gives us another reason for this rightful fear of God and obedience to him. And it says in verse 14, for God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil. He says, despite appearances, this is a moral universe and there is a judge who sits on the throne. And every single thing that happens in this world matters. And every single thing for good or evil will one day be presented at the throne of that judgment to receive a verdict. On the one hand, for those of you who are suffering, who have suffered injustice, who've been the victim of things that should never have happened to you, take heart. Those things will be judged. Every single thing that nobody else saw, nobody else understood, God sees. And he will deal with it with perfect justice. At the same time, be warned. Every one of your evil deeds will one day come to light. Every single one. The ones that nobody else saw. The ones that nobody else knows about. In the deepest, darkest parts of your heart and brain, those things will be brought forward. They too will receive their verdict. It's a warning to us. Fear God and keep his commandments. And if you're sitting there thinking to yourself, well, when all of that stuff is revealed, I feel pretty confident that as God brings out my bad stuff and he brings out my good stuff, I'm pretty sure that my good stuff is going to be more than my bad stuff. And I'll be okay. And I just want to tell you that's not how it works. It's not how it works. It's commonly believed, it's not true. See, like Taylor Swift said, it's me, I'm the problem. And what you'll discover on that day is that God is not going to look at you in the judgment and say, thanks for all your help. He's going to say, you were the problem. You're part of the problem. And if the only righteousness you have before God that day is your own righteousness, you will not stand in the judgment. And that's precisely why God gave his son to come and to die on a cross and bear the judgment in your place, because he knew you couldn't get through that judgment. We're all guilty. We're finished as far as that goes. He wouldn't have sent his son to come and die if there was another way for us to be righteous. Now he gives his righteousness as a gift to the guiltiest among us. It's free. You can take it. Just receive it. Saying, I believe it was for me, and I will receive it. And you will be forgiven, and you will stand in the day of judgment. And to be clear, believers and unbelievers, we will be there at the judgment. But here's the thing. For the believer, the judgment will not be a judgment of condemnation. It will be a judgment of commendation. Listen to how Paul puts it in 1 Corinthians 4. He says, therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive his commendation from God. There is a day coming when all of your little acts of obedience are going to get God's commendation. And that's intended to be a motivation for us. It's not the chief motivation for why we obey him, but it's a motivation for us to obey him. It means that whenever in the secret place of your mind, that lustful thought comes into your head, and you could indulge it, but instead you say, no way. Out of love and reverence for Jesus, you push away that thought, and nobody else sees and nobody else knows. God sees, and he will commend you for your faithfulness. When you suffer in ways that nobody else sees, but you're suffering out of love and reverence for Jesus, when you're making sacrifices for the good of another person, when you are loving even when it hurts, when you're bearing injustice faithfully and entrusting your soul to God in the midst of it, nobody else knows or sees, but God sees. And one day he's going to say to you, I saw that. Way to go. And if you've ever had a coach put your hand on your shoulder and say, that was awesome. You know how you swell, how good that feels. Imagine when it is your maker, the God who loved you and gave himself up for you, saying, I saw that. Well done. What would we not do out of love and reverence for God like that? He sees it all. And that's the conclusion here of Ecclesiastes. The fact that everything is ultimately going to be brought into the light of the judgment causes us to say, not that nothing matters, but actually everything matters. Everything. I lost my pencil one time when I was writing and doing what you do with a pencil on paper, and I couldn't find it anywhere. And so I'm looking around my desk and looking around my books and then looking under the desk and all the nooks and crannies that are around, and I'm trying to find this pencil. I can't find it anywhere. I ask the people around me, have you seen the pencil? Nobody's seen it. It's gone. And so eventually I go to my neighbor and I say to my neighbor, I lost my pencil. Do you have one I could borrow? And he says to me, do you mean the pencil above your ear? I said, yeah, that's the one. Yeah. With some surprise and embarrassment. And after relating that story, Zach Eswine writes these words. He says, sometimes the things we go searching for are with us all along. You will be tempted to think that you must move beyond the wisdom words of God in order to make a difference and find your purpose. His words will at times seem too small and quiet a thing amid the clamor and importance of the world. You'll be tempted to think that you need something more than your relationship with God in order to prove worthy and credible under the sun. But after everything is said and done, the end of the matter, the grand purpose for which we live, the The whole duty of your life is this: trust God, follow what he says. It's as simple as that. We can search the world high and low, and the answer is right here. In the midst of this world, in the midst of the heavenliness of life, in the midst of a world in which you are here for a brief time and then you're gone, where good things happen to bad people and bad things happen to good people, how should you live? Fear God and keep his commandments. And no matter how that turns out under the sun, you can have confidence that you are living it rightly. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the scriptures that are able to make us wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. And for those who don't have that faith today, I pray that you will cause them to be born again, that you will open the eyes of their heart to see the beauty of Jesus, the ugliness of sin, and the freeness of the salvation he freely offers to all who will believe and receive it. For us who know you, Lord, help us to rightly revere, stand in awe of who you are, and to be moved by love and by this proper fear to walk in obedience to all of your commands. Thank you for your goodness to us, even when we falter and fail, and that the salvation of Jesus is perfect and it is finished. We pray these things in his name. Amen.